have with us Professor Sripath Karmakar. Thank you, Sripath, for coming and welcome. It is my pleasant duty to introduce Professor Karmakar to all of you. He has been an IIT Madras guy most of his life. He did his BTEC, skipped MTEC and directly did his PhD. He has worked in some American university, University of California at Santa Barbara, Rensselaer Polytechnic, I think, and University of South California. South Carolina. Oh, in Columbia. Okay. He has been teaching at IIT Madras for many years. He is now a full professor there of electrical engineering, an accomplished researcher himself. He has won several awards. So in 2005, he received the Vikram Sarabhai Award, and in 2007, the IBM Faculty Award. He has actually a one semester video course on solid state devices, which is hosted on YouTube. So you can see that he is a passionate educator and a great researcher. In fact, I always keep saying that if you want to be a good educator, you should be a good researcher. And if you want to be a good researcher, you should be a good educator, because there are several complementary aspects of both these activities that an academic professional engages in. Apart from his academic achievements, which are great, Professor Karmakar has also handled very difficult administrative tasks. He was the chairman of Joint Entrance Examination 2007, I think, 2006. He is also a member of the National Working Group on Nanotechnology, which the Department of IT has set up. More specifically to educational technology and educational activities, he has been the coordinator of the Educational Technology Cell of IIT Madras. From our point of view, his most important contribution has been his passion to tell young researchers or those who wish to get into research and advise them on issues which arise when you try to understand, appreciate and conduct research. As I had briefly mentioned in the morning, a few years ago we had invited him to talk to our research scholars who are regular full-time PhD students. He gave a series of lectures which we actually put in open source. They are downloadable even today. The lectures made such an impact that the institute started thinking of introducing a regular one semester course on introduction or on research and research methodologies. We therefore invited him to speak to all of you to tell us about his own ideas and his perception of what research is. Although he specializes in talking to research scholars who are essentially full-time PhD students, but he very much appreciates the problems faced by working teachers who are required to undertake research while they are doing teaching. I am sure you will enjoy his lectures and learn a lot from him. He is going to tirelessly engage with us tomorrow the whole day, I think, and maybe day after tomorrow, practically whole day. So without further ado, I will request Professor Karmakar to get on with a series of lectures, and thank you once again.
So I wish to thank Professor Phatak for inviting me for this, and I really feel privileged to be participating in this whole exercise. In the morning, the minister said that out of collaboration, different people come together and share their expertise and do something for the country. I think this is a great opportunity, and I should thank Professor Phatak for giving me this opportunity to share my ideas on such a platform which he has developed. Though the word used for the mode of communication and the exchanges that will take place is lecture, actually I would like the sessions to be interactive. firstly, because it's an afternoon session, if it is not interactive, you may tend to go to sleep. That is why you will see that I am standing actually while delivering the lecture rather than sitting, because I should be wide awake if I should keep you awake. And so I would really like your interactions with me to be spontaneous, and please do not expect that I will tell you a number of things and at the end I will ask, are there any questions and so on. No, that is not the mode in which we would like. In today's discussions on pedagogy, you know, there is a lot of discussion on how to improve teaching. People talk about two things. One is learning outcomes. So people say that instead of prescribing a syllabus for a course, we must tell the students what will they get at the end of this course. So following that procedure, let me tell you what are the learning outcomes of this particular course. So in this course, we discuss answers to the following questions. So at the end of this course, you will get answers to these questions. First, what are the motivation and objectives of a course such as introduction to research? Then, what are the differences between course-based undergraduate or postgraduate education and research education? What are the habits, skills, and attitudes required for research, and how do I develop them? How can I develop my thinking to generate ideas? In how many different ways, tabular, graphical, or other, can I present the data? Then, how can I find a problem and formulate a hypothesis? What, how, and how much literature do I read? What are the essential elements of scientific methods? How do I design setups and experiments and ensure accuracy in measurements? In fact, today morning's talk, Professor Sukhatme did touch upon many of these points, which are going to be developed in more detail here. How can one be an effective and efficient oral or written communicator? Then, where and how do I publish or patent my work? And finally, how do I manage stress, time, and my guide or research student? You know, this is a very important point. Professor Sukhatme told in the morning that you work with a guide for your PhD. So it is very important to maintain good relations between the student and the guide. So we will discuss some of the reasons because of which stresses arise in this relation and how to avoid them. What are the ethical issues in research? So today morning, for example, Professor Sukhatme mentioned about plagiarism. So things like that. And finally, any other questions you may have, okay, please feel free to interrupt and ask me questions or make comments. So it is not even questions. If you have some comments to make, right, I welcome them, because most of you are teachers in your own places. Now, we are going to have some activities during the course, in fact, a number of them. Now, why are activities very important? Here is a quotation which says, when I hear, I forget. So, if I try to learn only by hearing from others, then most likely after I have heard, in some time I am likely to forget the matter. When I see, I remember. So, seeing is very important. But even if I see, I will remember, but still I may not learn. When I do, I learn. So this is a very important aspect of human psychology, that learning happens by doing, not only by hearing or just seeing. It is therefore important that the learning process includes not only lecturing, but also activities. I mentioned to you about one important development in pedagogy, and today people are talking about learning outcomes rather than syllabus. Another important thing that people are talking about in new teaching methods is what is called active cooperative learning, where it is not that the teacher comes with some material and then goes on talking about it and you sit passively and listen. So the learning has to be active and cooperative. So cooperative because the teacher and the students or the audience should interact and discuss and come up to answers to the questions. So that is what I would like the mode to be. So let me mention some of the important activities that will be there apart from the interaction that I just spoke to you about, like your questions and my answers and so on, which will be there throughout. One important activity that we will have is a group discussion. So this group discussion will be based on the talk, you and your research. And this talk is available on the internet, okay, in the form of a text. And this talk was delivered by a very well-known researcher called Richard Hamming. He is well-known in the area of electrical engineering. But the talk is not about electrical engineering. This is very important to understand. The talk talks about good research. What are the habits of good researchers? Right? What is the meaning of a good research problem? How much time should one develop, should one spend in developing communication skills? For example, Richard Hamming says that you must develop, you must spend 50% of your time in research on communication. That is the importance of communication, writing and presenting talks and so on. I do not know if you have come across any such statement earlier. People think that in research you spend all your time doing thinking and then write up, right? Or go and, you know, talk about it to your students or your peers and so on. As though this talking or writing up is just like the output unit of a computer which prints out things. As we will see, reading, writing and speaking, these are all very important ways of thinking, not only imparting or disseminating your whatever you have developed. So this material is available on the internet, both in the complete form. In the complete form, this talk runs into 24 pages of text. But there are abridged versions also available on the internet. If you search for abridged versions, you will get abridged versions also. And it, in fact, it is very easy to locate it on the internet. If you just put in Google search, you and your research, you will get the material. So this discussion will be held day after tomorrow in the afternoon session. So I am telling you in the morning, in the afternoon of today. So I hope today night and tomorrow night you will have time to go through this material, and then we will assemble together for a discussion. You will, each participant will tell, right, what are the important points he or she gathered from this particular article. The other activity, important activity that we are going to have is 10-minute PowerPoint presentations by two participants on topics of their choice but of general interest to the audience. So I am going to identify the participants. I have to do a lottery, I can't help, because there are so many of you here. So these two participants will choose topics of their choice. But when they make a choice, they must remember that in the audience you have people of all disciplines, engineering, sciences and even humanities. So please choose a topic and present it in a manner in which everyone will be able to appreciate the significance of what you are talking. Okay? So in fact, that is what communication skill is about. So you will make the presentations and then we will analyze this presentation and see where things could be improved, what are the strengths of these presentations and so on. So this activity will be there tomorrow afternoon. So I suggest that the two participants who are identified, please prepare this presentation tonight, okay, and come ready with this tomorrow. Now before I identify the participant, let me complete the remaining part of this slide. There will be a 10-minute thinking exercise today in the next session on productive thinking. which will be meant to give an appreciation of their various levels of thinking. Then apart from these activities which will happen during our next 2 or 3 days, there will be some activities which will be given to you in the form of assignments. So, you please do them to get maximum benefit from this course. And before closing this thing on activities, one important activity that you should be doing all the time throughout the lectures is to take notes. I am going to discuss a little bit in more detail why taking notes is important and how notes are taken. Every researcher should take notes. But for now, I will just mention that you should be taking notes. Okay? So, please do not sit and just listen to me because you are likely to forget later on. Make quick notes, and this will also help you to ask meaningful questions. Okay. Now, let us identify the participants. Okay? So, 2 participants, since the audience is from Kashmir to Kanyakumari and from Gujarat to maybe Tripura. So, let me randomly try to identify maybe one person from, can you identify a remote center in Kashmir? Achha, okay, yeah, DOEACC Srinagar. Yes, so can we identify one participant from this center who will make the 10-minute presentation of PowerPoint?
Like. Yes, sir. Habibullah, sir, I can make the voluntary presentation for 10 minutes. Yes, sir. Oh, sir, the topic should be, sir, open?
Yes, you can choose your own topic. See to it that it is of interest to.
Yes, we can prepare this presentation for tomorrow's session on voluntary basis.
So, now let's go to Kanyakumari, the other end. Kanyakumari, are you able to hear me? The center, St. Xavier's College of Engineering. So, I would like. There are a large number of women there. Can any one of the women volunteer? Because I already have Mr. Habibullah. So I would like a lady to make a presentation.
Hello, good afternoon, sir. My name is Veena. I'm an assistant professor in Department of MCA in this college, Sensei.
Okay. Okay, Mrs. Veena, thank you. We'll look forward to your presentation. Yeah. So let us proceed further. So we have identified 2 people, Habibullah and Reena, who will make presentations tomorrow, and we will discuss about their presentation, see how things can be improved. Now, as far as the group discussion that I mentioned, that is open for all. Okay, so any person in the audience can make a point. Okay, now what you should do is you must learn to make your point crisply, right? So please prepare well, so that you, because there are 9,000 or 10,000 people, to be fair to everyone, please prepare yourself before making the point, before coming to the discussion, and make your point in a few sentences, okay? Maybe couple of sentences or even one sentence. So this will be an exercise in communication. You will learn how to communicate orally better, right? As I mentioned, Richard Hamming says that you must spend 50% of your research time in developing ability to communicate, ask questions meaningfully. Okay, let's proceed further. Let me mention some reference material. These are some books which are available and which are very reasonably priced. You can get them anywhere. One is a book titled How to Get a PhD. Next is a book titled Practical Physics, and then third one is a book on communication, science communication. So the second book, although it is titled Practical Physics, I would have probably titled it as Experimental Skills. So it gives an impression that the book is about physical experiments, but no, the way the discussion goes on in the book, it is good for any experimentalist in any area. So, since the slides will be uploaded, you need not spend too much time taking down these details of the book. You can have them with you because slides will be there. So now, let us take up the first question. What are the motivation and objectives of a course such as Introduction to Research? Why do we need a course like this? Now, there are several motivations for this. One very important motivation: status of research in India. All research institutes, their vision is excellence in research, right? So that is what is shown there as the first part of the slide. Now, what is the ground reality? Low impact of large scientific manpower. So India has, it is said, third or second largest scientific manpower in the world. So this is the number of people engaged in learning about science and so on, right? That is what is meant by scientific manpower and practicing science. This here science includes engineering also. Now, what do we mean by low impact? Now, this is important. How do you assess the impact of research? If it is not in the number of people, then what is it that we talk about while we talk about impact? One parameter is the level of skill. It is not the number of people, but the level of skill possessed by people, right? That is what decides the impact. Let us discuss the word impact a little bit more. So, one way of assessing impact could be, there are some journals coming out of India, Indian journals. Now, what is their status in the world scene? Okay. So, for instance, if you take an area like engineering, say people may like to publish in a journal like IEEE Transactions, right, on electron devices, communications and so on. Why? Because you feel that journal is reputed. So, a country like United States, you say, you know, the impact, it makes a large impact on the scientific scene. So, a journal from that country will have a good reputation. So, people from elsewhere also would like to publish in that. Now, similarly, let us look at journals which are published from India. How many people elsewhere would like to publish in this journal? How many good researchers would like to publish in this journal? So, this would be one way of assessing impact. Now, when I discuss these things, it is important to note that we are not trying to deride anything, because after all, the purpose of this course is to develop the research spirit, and it will be against this motivation to deride anything, but we must be aware of the reality and we want to move ahead from there. The second point noted there is low average drags the peak down or drives it away. Now, if the average level of research activity is low, even the good researchers do not like to stay in such an environment. So, they tend to go out to other places. So, if you want to improve the impact of Indian research, we must raise the average level. This is very important. So, a large number of people should be doing good research, if not excellent research. If large number of people do good research, then a few will do excellent research, and then you can get Nobel Prizes out, right? So, this is important. If you see countries around wherever there are Nobel Prize winners or any other parameters of research impact. For example, another parameter of research impact is technologies that you import or you develop, technologies for different products. How often do we import technologies? Okay, if you are importing all the technologies, important things, then we say, you know, we may be active scientifically, but we are not developing anything that is of great substance. So, a country which is strong in research would develop technologies and maybe export technologies. We are doing well in the area of IT sector. We do export software and so on. But in materials oriented areas like semiconductors or other materials also, steel and so on, we tend to import technology. So, materials and devices is an area where we need to improve. So there is a gap between the excellence in research, that is our vision, and the ground reality. Now, this gap needs to be closed. So, how do we do it? So, it is the purpose of a course like this to develop the research spirit, okay, give a taste for research and make people feel that research is something that is worth doing, worth taking up as a career. And IIT, many IIT teachers express this doubt. We are proud of our BTECs. are we equally proud of our PhDs? This is another way of probably assessing whether our research is making impact. If we are proud of our PhDs, yes, then we can say that yes, we are making impact. So, we can summarize by saying there is an urgent need to strengthen research culture and instill confidence and professional pride in research scholars. So, this course is an exercise in that direction. Let us look at the PhD educational process. Okay, it is a model. So, here you find that this is the box which is PhD education. The input is BTech or MTech student. Here I use BTech and MTech. You must, because I am from an institute of technology, but equally well you could call BE or BSc, MSc and so on, right. So, all such science or engineering graduates. So, they are the inputs. And then they go through this education, PhD education, and then come out as PhD scholars. So, when they come out as PhD scholars, they need to have right attitude, skills and knowledge. So, we are going to discuss what is meant by right attitude, what are the skills and so on. Now, another input in this PhD education is given by the institute in the form of teachers, peers. So, for a research scholar, for any student for that matter, a student learns not only from teachers, but also from peers. Now, why is IIT is such a sought after place? If you ask an IIT student, I am one myself, how much did I learn from teachers and how much did I learn from peers? So, if you have very active, competent peers around, you learn a lot from them. So, these two can be said to constitute the human resources. And then you need facilities, right? So, that is included in material resources. So, you have two forms of resources, human and material being put in to develop a PhD scholar. So, if you want to improve the level of a PhD scholar, there are many things which need to be done, all of which will not be talked about in this course because, for example, how do I increase this level of the input? How do I improve the quality of the input here, right? Now, this is something that we may not be able to talk because beyond the scope of this course. On the other hand, a topic that would be very much relevant to this course would be among the teachers, the guide is a very important person, right, who influences the research PhD education. So, how do I maintain good relations with between guide and students? How good relations can be maintained? This is very important for good. So, this is one thing that could form a part of this course. Similarly, PhD education, what kind of courses should be prescribed for a PhD scholar so that he or she develops the right attitude and skills. So, a course, the one a course such as the one we are talking about can be one thing that we could include in the PhD education process. So, these are the kind of things that we are going to discuss in this course. So, the role of teachers is particularly important because all of your teachers, I am emphasizing this fact. So, what is their role? So, their role is in planning and organizing, motivating, very important. So, if you want good research scholars to come up, then there should be motivated guides, inspiring teachers, and then controlling. Some of these points, in fact, were mentioned by Dr. Sukhatme also in the morning of how it is important to be with a good guide for doing good research. Now, it is not proper to just discuss things over a cup of tea and so on and leave them. There is a quotation which says, philosophers have only interpreted the world in various ways. The point, however, is to change it. So, very often we discuss about many difficulties and so on, but we discuss only in the manner of interpreting things, right? Why is this happening like that? No, we have a reason, we have a theory for it. Oh, you know, this is the reason why it is happening. And we leave it at that, but that is not correct. The point, however, is to change it. So, your discussion and so on should be backed up with practice so that things change for better. So, in this course, that is the spirit that we have to have, meaning everything that we discuss, we are discussing towards actually practicing the ideas, right? No ideas are being discussed in this course which are just to be taken as ideas and left, okay? So everything is meant, is directed towards practice. So now we need to be humble about the objectives that can be achieved by a course. So the course aims at seeding research attitude and skills. We are not trying to say that if you go through a course like this, which may run into say 30 or 40 hours, we are not saying that at the end of it, you know, you are going to become great researchers immediately. The course alone cannot do it. What the course will do is it will do a seeding process. In other words, this is illustrated with the help of an analogy. Supposing I have a substrate and then I want to paint or plate a substrate, and I want this plating to adhere to the substrate, a common practice is to deposit a seed layer. This seed layer helps you to maintain good adherence between the plating and the substrate. So you are painting a wall. So what do? You first apply a distemper and then you paint it the way you want. So the role of the distemper is to keep the paint and the wall together for a sufficiently long time. So that is the role of this course. So in this analogy, if research scholars are regarded as the substrate and research attitude and skills is like the paint, then the introduction to research course is like a distemper, right? So it will help you to, it will sensitize you towards the right attitudes and skills, and it will also tell you how to develop them. So hopefully if you do the, if you do a course like this, the process of development will be enhanced, right? The speed at which things will develop will be enhanced. Another way you can look at the course is like a map. Science is like research is like exploration. We discussed in the morning that something new should come out of it. What is the definition of a thesis? It was given in the morning. We will have an opportunity to revisit that definition. But something new should come out. That is very important. Now, that is what is the purpose of exploration. In exploration, you come up with new things. And whenever you want to do exploration, you need a map. Suppose you want to climb Himalayas, right? You will take a map. What does this map do? So it tells you what are the likely pitfalls and so on, right? And how to prepare for them. So this course will tell you which are the difficult points where you should take care. Okay? So this course can be regarded as a map for undertaking research. In fact, when I first mooted the idea of a course like this in my own institution, IIT Madras, a number of senior guys, they said, well, you know, all these kind of things like courses on introduction to research and so on, they don't be of much benefit. Okay? Because after all, how did we do research? They said. They said, we learnt about research by going through it. So you 5 years of research you do with a guide, and at the end of 5 years, you know what research is all about. So we don't believe that a course is required for this. Now, in this context, it is very important to look at this particular quotation. It is true that there is no substitute for experience in understanding of the research process. This is true not only of research process, but many other things in life. There is no substitute for experience, but important, experience without thought is a slow and painful way of learning. So this is very important. We might have learned many things during the course of 5 or 6 years in a painful way, in a slow manner, right? So we could make things better. So a course like this helps you to make things less painful and enhance the speed of things, right? Speed of learning about research. So after matters were presented in this fashion, then many people felt convinced, yes, probably we should try out a course like this and see whether it benefits. And experience shows that many people who have done the course did benefit. I will have the opportunity to seek your feedback also. You can be honest in telling me whether this course benefited you or not. Now, when I ask for this feedback, you must note some more points. The course has two components, one that will be of immediate use and another whose significance will be apparent in the long run. So you must go through the material in this course periodically when you are doing research. Supposing we say that, you know, it is a 4 or 5 year period for doing PhD. Probably every 6 months you should revisit this material, and then you will find it becoming more and more useful. It may not be possible to appreciate all the points right in the beginning. So therefore, when I say that I would like to have feedback on whether or not a course like this helps, then it would be important to take an immediate feedback after you have done this set of lectures, and then get some feedback after 6 months, after 3-4 years, after you are done, in case you are doing a PhD. That would be important. This is true of all education. We may not know its impact immediately. And finally, your research career does not end, but rather begin. It begins with an MS or a PhD degree. Okay? So you are beginning your research career with a PhD. That is not the end of research. And therefore, a course such as this is very important right in the beginning. Let us move on to the next couple of questions. Now, before I do that, I said that I would like this course to be interactive. So I would like to pause at this time and seek some comments or questions. So I mentioned to you in the beginning that, you know, we have to do the learning in a cooperative way, not only in the lecture mode. So I spoke for some time because I have to introduce some ideas. But now, let us have some comments or questions from you. Yes.
Sir, good afternoon. This is Dr. Balamurugan from Institute of Road and Transport Technology. Sir, this is regarding the questions you have put on the slides. What are the differences between the course offered in UG and PG education and research? So as far as I am concerned, the UG courses mainly deals with the basics, fundamentals, and a little bit on applications. And when it comes to PG education, we can say 50% on the advances of the fundamentals and 50% on the application side. And slightly the PG subjects are related to or slightly adjusted towards the research education. And this is the answer for the first question. And the answer for the second question, what are the habits, skills, and attitudes required for research, and how do I develop them? And based upon the Sugatmi's lecture in the morning, we can easily say that the person who is interested in pursuing research should have the perseverance and the patience and the continuous learning. So these are the three important things we feel that which are required for any researcher, whether he is looking for MS or PhD or later he want to become the supervisor. Thank you, sir. Over and out.
Yes. Just a comment on the answer you gave to the first question. You told what happens in undergraduate and PG education. Now the question is, what is the difference between that education which you spoke about and research? You didn't mention about research. You said that some fundamentals are discussed in UG, then some advanced topics in PG, and then what happens in research? So what is the difference?
Sir, in research education, basically it is the coursework subjects are selected based upon the area of research, and in few occasions if the university syllabus is not strict to the research area, then probably the supervisor or the person who is supervising that particular candidate can set their own topics or what I can say syllabus for the particular research scholar to take up the research. So basically the research education falls under a narrow area. In a nutshell, we can say that it is only a deep details about a particular area.
So let me summarize what you said. You said that BTech is fundamentals, MTech is like advanced topics, and you concentrate on one area and go very deep, that is what is research. Okay. Now, we will see what are the other important differences, right? Let me move on to, if there are no other comments, are there any other comments from this center? Okay. Well, let us move on to another center.
NIE Mysore.
Good afternoon. My name is Vidya Raj, sir, professor of computer. Yes, sir. The question number one, what are the differences between course-based UGPG education and research education? In my opinion, UGPG is curriculum based with fixed curriculum based, whereas PhD education is knowledge based. Point number one. Point number two, UGPG education is teacher driven, whereas PhD education is self driven and motivated by mentors like guides. Number three, UGPG education has learning moderated, whereas
PhD education has a variable speed. So I feel there is a context is different for both of them. Both of them do depend completely on the basics what we have applied, learned, but PhD education is much, much more than what is available in UG and PG curriculum. Thank you.
Good points.
Habits, skills and attitudes required for research and how do I develop them? I feel the habits required to be continuous learnability. So one needs to have the motivation to learn new things, acquire skills which are out of the textbooks, and then attitude is again learnability and try to listen to others when they correct you. So I feel these are the attitudes required. Thank you, sir.
Okay, any more?
Amrita Coimbatore, go ahead.
You know, in most of our discussions, finally, what I feel is at the research level, you are making your own contribution. That means finally you have a law of your own or a hypothesis of your own. And even at undergraduate level, though it is only basic which are taught, he should finally make the knowledge his own itself. So earlier we make somebody else's knowledge our own, and at research level, we create our own knowledge and make it our own. Over to you, sir.
Yes, I got your point. We will discuss about it. I am noting the points.
SRM Kanchipuram, go ahead.
I am from the maths department. I am attending your lecture from today morning. The very first question that you have addressed to us, what are the differences between course-based UGPG education and research? As far as mathematics is concerned, we are only given an overall introduction in the UG, sir. As we go to PG, we deal only with mathematics subjects and with the computer-based subjects. And later on, when we go to research, we slowly shift towards application side or purely towards analytical skills. All the three seem to be totally independent. They are not interlinked at all in certain cases. In my case, I did my UG with Madras University. I had only final year 5 core papers, first year and second year 1 core math, allied physics, chemistry. In my PG, it was all analysis I did from Ramanujan Institute of Study. Right now, I'm employed with an engineering college. My research is totally based with communication protocols and queuing theory related to it. So this is how we distinguish with respect to mathematics. So I just like to put a word about this to you.
Okay. So now we are going to come in sequence, Shastra, then Warangal and Prasad Engineering College Warangal, and then the college at Jaipur. So let's start with Shastra. Let's see what is your question or comment.
Sir, I have a simple question to ask in the fellow research work. That imagine a very known problem is there in the field of engineering literature, and we find that one author has solved the problem P using a method A, and he got some accuracy of, suppose let me assume, alpha. And then the same problem is solved by another author using another method and got some solution, suppose accuracy beta. Okay, now third author, he has done is, he has combined the two methods, that is called hybridization of the methods, and solved the problem, same problem P, and got solution gamma, and the gamma solution, the latest solution, is much more better than the previous solutions. Now what my question in this particular issue is that the third author who has solved the problem using the hybridized method of previous two, can this work, can be regarded as a novelty? Or it can be regarded as a novel work? That is a question, sir, to my problem.
No, please repeat your last sentence. Can it be regarded as?
The work done by the third author, can it be regarded as a novel work in the field of research work?
Yeah, I understand your question. Shall I answer it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what you are talking about is the same problem is being solved in different ways by different people. Okay. Now, can these different ways be regarded as novel? Can it be regarded as a novel work? Now, you are saying that you talked about only accuracy of the final result. But there are other issues. In anything, there are two aspects, efficiency okay, and effectiveness. So let's say accuracy and efficiency. It is important just how much computation you had to do to arrive at the answer. So if a particular method is such that it reduces computation by a large amount, then it would be a significantly new work. So you understand, you have to look at different parameters of the work. You mentioned only about accuracy of the result. That may not be sufficient. For example, if one method gives an accuracy of say 50% and another method gives accuracy of 5%, then definitely even in terms of the accuracy alone, the one work is much better than the other. But on the other hand, if method A gives you accuracy of 5% and method B gives you accuracy of 3%, right, then you will have to look for other parameters, because the 3 and 5% these accuracies are very close, right, not a significant achievement. So you must see whether amount of computation, amount of effort that is required to arrive at the result. So that would be another parameter that you must look at to decide whether there is a novelty. Does it answer your question?
Yeah, it answers partly.
Yeah, please. You said it answers partly. So what is it that it doesn't answer?
Thing is, as I said, the third author uses method A and B, which are already existing methods. Method A and B already existing methods. Third author has actually hybridized the method and got a better solution in terms of accuracy. Hence, there are other metrics to be considered while evaluating a particular work. Here I just told about accuracy. Some other methods are also there, like sensitivity values, then specificity values. Let me not go through much complexity in this discussion. So let me assume some other parametrics also. But if I see that other metrics are also much more better compared to the old one, I mean other results, which are the results of other authors. But the point is that the method that I have obtained, so third author, which is a hybridization of the existing other methods, but where is the novelty? Because this is not something new, it is an existing one.
Look, the hybridization itself in some sense is new, right? Other people have not attempted. That is why what I said is that it is important to see what did the hybridization achieve in terms of effort and final result, right? Because if the hybridization achieved significantly greater simplicity, then even if the hybridization appears simple, right, it is still an achievement. So we have to look for other parameters, and based on you cannot decide based on only one thing. You understand? That is the point I am making, right? So there are there is method A, there is method B. Somebody says I combine method A and method B, right? But if the two methods have been combined in such a way that things have become very simple, then definitely it is some achievement. Okay. So what I will suggest to you is that some things like this will be discussed, right? And at the end of that discussion, if you still have this question, then we will see. You may get answers to some of these questions during the course of the lectures, right? This particular question. So since I know you have many more questions, we would like to move on to the next place, and that is Warangal. Right. Yes, Prasad Engineering College, Warangal.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Prasad Engineering College from Janagam, Andhra Pradesh. So you have a question that what are the differences between course-based UG and PG education and research education. So in that, UG is nothing but here we have to do the work with together of students, and PG is nothing but whatever we have studied in UG that we have to implement in research education, directly implementing whatever we are implementing, that just we have to work on them, work together. And habits, skills and attitudes required to research is just you have to work, just the habits and skills attitudes required to research is here. We have to just, you have mentioned in the slides that 10 minutes thinking exercise to gain appreciation of the levels of thinking, a number of assignments have to be done by the every participant motivation, that is in that motivation that you have to have a vision in the reality of the excellence group discussion regarding the research to develop something, whatever we are doing the work on the research, and focus we have to be on the sports also is a very good requirement to research on the particular thing that whatever we are doing. We have to maintain the good relation with the faculty members, philosophers have only the interpreted to in the world of various ways.
Hello sir. Hello. Good afternoon sir. I'm another participant from the same Prasad Engineering College, Rajeshwar Raju. Regarding this education of your based undergraduation, PG and research sir. Undergraduation is what I feel is like the collecting all the facts which you have learned from our basic intermediate and mathematics. And then sir, coming to the PG education, it is like application sir. Now coming to the research, the most important point is of the habits, skills and attitudes sir. As you have said, in the starting of this session, you should the research should be a good impact. Like now the problem is of sir, with this EMF waves, the most important subject is regarding this electromagnetic interference sir. Now coming to the habits and skills, we know that these radiations are being affected sir, to the human brain. Now we can see some of the towers like they are producing more energy waves than the required one. If we get some software or some chip is being designed in such a way that how much is appropriated to our limitations, sir, if the research is going on that good habit like, let the technology be there which is used in a good purposeful way, sir. But let not the technology dominate the human brain or it may kill the health of the people. So what I request is the second question which you are giving, the habits, skills and attitudes, is one of the most important for the good impact in the research technology, sir. If we think in this particular positive way, definitely as per your second, this one, it might be a good thing, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
So we are coming to the Jaipur College.
Yes, sir, my question is about the impact factor. Nowadays, we have got lots of mail that there are certain journals publishing the paper against some money. But what is really happened that we are misguided by that. But I personally feel that, if a journal charges some money, then does this valuable or not to publish a paper? They claim that they have such a 5 impact factor or 4 impact factor. But I personally feel in computer science, even that journal of IEEE transaction network could have hardly 2.3 impact factor. Is it okay to publish in such journals? And there might be a case that some good paper are published in these journals. So, how could we refer these journals in future or are we carried away? Like if I want to publish a paper in IEEE Transaction Network or some other journal reported, then it might took a year or two. But if this is a kind of software that I can go for some journal which had ISBN number or whatever and they publish my paper for certain reason. So is it okay to publish in this paper in these journals? And one suggestion about my on this UG and PG courses that basically, it's UG and PG courses hardly matter at IITs or NITs because at there the course coordinator or professor had the power to change the syllabus accordingly to depend or impart new knowledge to the students. But the institutes like us, where we are registered to some university like Technical University, the syllabus is so bad they changes in 10 years or 6 years. By that time, all technologies are modified or we get some new technology in the years. So it might be easy that if the syllabus is updated every year in such institutes. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, many participants have made comments and then I will try to summarize the answers to these questions in the next few slides. So, this slide mentions what is the objective of each of the degrees. Bachelor's education, any area, engineering, sciences, take any area. The goal is general education. Some of you mentioned this as fundamentals. Masters by coursework, possession of advanced knowledge. Many of you said this correctly. Now, as far as doctorate or master's education by research, What is the objective? I think this is where you need to make a note of this point, because something that didn't come out as clearly in your answers, it is a license to teach and guide others. It is only after you do research that you get a license to teach and guide others. So that is the goal of doctorate education. Now let us expand on this particular point a little bit. Now one can teach and guide others when one has a knowledge of what is being discovered, argued about and published in a subject all over the world. This is a first criterion for license. Then an ability to evaluate the worth of what others are doing. Then an ability to identify areas where one can make a useful contribution. And finally, an ability to communicate one's ideas and results effectively in international professional circles. So even when you are answering questions or making comments, such as in a place like what we are doing, this is where one must communicate ideas and results effectively. So I should get the same meaning from what you are saying as you intended. Okay, so now these four are the criteria for license to teach and guide others. So you can make note of these points and check for yourself, right? How well do you satisfy these criteria if you are doing teaching and guiding others? Now many times people say, well, there are many teachers who don't have a PhD or who have not done research. Well, I mean, that is what is bad about professional education. If there are teachers who have not done PhDs or not done research, then their effectiveness in teaching and guiding others will be very limited. We must however note that there can be people with research temperament, though they may not have a degree. So in such cases, even without doing a PhD, okay, there may be teachers who are doing well, but by and large it is a fact that unless you go through a PhD education or research education, you will not get the license to teach and guide others. So this is the most important goal of research education. Now let us discuss this point further. This is a summary. In fact, some of you did mention this. To get the license to teach and guide others, one should be a manager of one's own learning and an independent thinker. So manager of one's learning and independent thinker, okay, these are the requirement for teaching and guiding others, or these are the things that one must get in research education. In bachelor's and master's education, a student's learning is managed by her teachers. So what is the meaning of manager of one's own learning, and what is the meaning of independent thinking, right? We must translate all these ideas into very practical terms so that we can judge for ourselves. We can tick and say, am I doing this? Is this the way I am doing? Yes, then I am an independent thinker. If I am not doing it this way, then probably I am not. So let's look at that in detail. Manager of one's own learning. This means that a research scholar should take initiative in choosing the research area and courses to be undergone. See, this is a very important point. How do you know whether you are managing your own learning? So are you deciding what courses you should do? Or rather, when you go to your guide, do you take a list of courses, possible courses that you could take? Or do you go to the guide and say, sir, what courses should I do? If you go to the guide and you are expecting the guide to tell you everything about what courses you should do, then you are not managing your own learning. Okay? Similarly, research area. You spend some time in reading up material and then go to your guide and say, I would probably like to work in this area. What do you think about it? Then the guide will tell you, right? No, maybe this is not a good thing to work on. Not much good work is going on. Why not you try this? So the point is, the initiative is from your side. It is not correct for a research scholar, for a person who has joined PhD, to go to the guide and say, sir, please tell me what is the problem I should work on, right? So ultimately, the guide is going to help you to zero in on the problem, but there should be an initiative from your side. So this is the first point about manager of one's own learning. How do you judge whether you are managing your own learning? Let's take independent thinking. When can you say that you are an independent thinker? you not only solve a problem, but also define it. This involves asking new questions. So to define a problem, a good research problem, it's not easy. In fact, people may take up to 50% or more than that of their time in research to actually define and formulate a good problem, right? An actual solution of that specific problem may take a couple of years, right? So defining a good problem is very, very important. So are you participating in definition of the problem? Then you are an independent thinker. Not only generate data, but also interpret it. If you are going to your guide and then telling, sir, I have collected the data as you have said, I made all these measurements. Now, what do I make out of this data? Please tell me. So if this is the way you go to your guide and you are asking questions, you are asking your guide to interpret it, then you are not an independent thinker. What you should be doing is you collect the data, then you think over it, develop an interpretation, develop an explanation, then go to your guide and tell that this is the explanation I have got, is this right? Then the guide will also sit with you and check whether what you have come up with is correct. So ultimately it is important to note, we are now talking about the differences between course based and research education. Research education blurs the distinction between a student and her mentor. Really, if the research is happening properly, correctly as it should happen, then the research scholar and the guide, the difference between them is going to progressively reduce. Okay? Ultimately, in fact, an ideal research is one in which, at least in a specific area which the research scholar has chosen, the scholar is better than the guide and more knowledgeable in that specific area. As a whole, the guide always remains more experienced, but in a specific area, the research scholar's knowledge and achievement is more than that of the guide, then only it is actually ideal research. So this is important to note about the difference between research education and undergraduate education or course based education. Now, because the distinction between mentor and the student goes on reducing, right, some problems in relationships can arise between the guide and the student. So when some difficulties are arising, you must note that one reason for that could be a natural process in which ideal research proceeds. So in fact, students who are manager of their own learning, who are very independent minded and so on, there can be difficulties in relation with the guide. So if one is aware of this pitfall, then one will be more careful in maintaining a good relation. Let me give you an example of this. Say writing up papers. If the student has spent a lot of time on the research problem and come up with a solution, explanation and everything, and then a paper is being written, it can happen that the student may have a different idea about how the paper should be written or the idea should be presented than the guide. And so it will happen that, you know, the guide will say, no, I don't think this is the way to effectively present it, maybe you should do it differently. But the student feels very strongly that it should be only written in a particular way. Now, if you are not aware that in any research this sort of a problem can happen, then you are likely to think that it is your guide who is really very nosy, right? Doesn't let you do things the way you would like to do. And on the other hand, the guide may feel my student doesn't respect my sentiments, right? It doesn't realize that I am much more experienced. So to avoid this kind of difficulties and to put some of the things that happen in a proper perspective, it is good to know these ideas about difference between research education and undergraduate and course based education. So going through some couple of other points which you have already made, unlike in an examination, in research you do not get well defined problems to solve. It is your job to define the problem as well as solve it. So far in all our examinations in BTech, MTech, BSc, MSc and so on, our grade sheets, what do they display, right? They display your ability to answer well defined questions. Of course, people do project work, and in project work there is an element of research in the sense you define your problem, a small problem, a BTech or MTech project, and then you are solving it. So some element of research is there in the grade that you get in a project. But otherwise, overall, what your grade reflects is only your ability to answer well-defined problem. Whereas in research, you have to define the problem yourself apart from solving it. And then before we break for tea, PhD MS is like time unbound examination, in which problems are different for different people. Final marks have to be more than a minimum, which is fairly high, but you are allowed multiple attempts to achieve the result. So, you can regard PhD or MS as a different kind of an examination, right? Some students take 4 years for PhD, some take 6 years, some take even more, but by and large people finish between, some students even finish within 3 years. Now, why this sort of a variation? Because different students are solving different types of problems. Their initial conditions are also different. One student takes a certain amount of time in formulating the research problem, while another student gets a reasonably well defined problem from the guide. Why? Because the previous students have done a lot of work and churned out a lot of problems. So, one cannot choose much in this matter. So, one must accept that things are different for different students. Now, final marks have to be more than a minimum. So, in a BTEC or MTEC examination, at the end of 3 hours, we collect the papers from the students. And then, well, if you have solved only 50% of the problems, you get 50% marks, right? And that is what is shown up in your grade card. But for PhD, this sort of thing will not work, right? You cannot say that I have done 4 years of work, I will write up whatever I have done for 4 years and submit as a PhD. That is not acceptable. Because, for example, in a place like IIT, for instance, it is required that out of your work, you have at least 2 good journal publications if you want to get a PhD degree, and at least 1 journal publication if you are doing an MS. So, that is the minimum you have to achieve. You may take more time for doing it, but unless you achieve that, you cannot get a degree. You are allowed multiple attempts to achieve the result. So, for instance, when you send a paper out for publication, it can happen that in the first instance, the paper is not accepted, right, and you get strong criticism. But then you have an opportunity to revise your work and then present it. Okay? So, there are multiple attempts allowed in this case, but the minimum is fairly high.